Hello, my name is Kristen Masters. I'm a professor in the Department of Biomedical Engineering here at the UW-Madison, and today I'm going to be talking about ethics and engineering design. So ethics and engineering design can be separated into two main areas. There's the research that you're going to be doing to create your design, and with respect to behaving ethically in that area, I'm going to be talking about avoiding scientific misconduct, much like we would talk about in terms of working in a lab, and conducting your research ethically. There's also the second part of your design, which is the how you construct your product. And inherent within that area of ethics is assessing risk and making sure that you're following appropriate codes and laws. So I'm going to start out with the scientific misconduct, because much of your semester for design is going to be focused on designing your product and doing some research in order to get to your design. So if you're not familiar with what scientific misconduct is, I'm going to read to you just a couple of definitions. Don't worry, it won't take too long. Some define scientific misconduct as intentional or gross negligence leading to fabrication of the scientific message or false credit or emphasis given to a scientist. Or another way that's put by the US government actually is fabrication, falsification, plagiarism, or other practices that seriously deviate from those that are commonly accepted within the scientific community. And it does not include honest error or honest differences in interpretations or judgments of data. So what I'm going to talk about today is what are some examples of some this scientific misconduct or unethical behavior, why do people do this, and what are some ways that you can avoid having scientific misconduct or ethical violations in your projects and careers, hopefully. So first, I like to start out with a little bit of I call it fun, because I think that some of the examples of what people have done over the years that have not been ethical are sometimes a little bit amusing. There are many, many instances over the years of ethical violations in research or design. It starts out, you know, way back when in the very early years, even people who were very famous for what they did, so Mendel and his genetics data, he is accused of smoothing that, even though that's what we base most a bunch of our genetics knowledge on these days. One that I find particularly fun is in the 1970s, a guy by the name of William Summerlin, he blackened spots on white mice with a permanent marker in order to make it look as if skin transplants from black mice had been successful. And probably more in your guys' lifetimes, there's, of course, the human embryonic stem cell scandals that have happened in South Korea. So more generic examples of scientific misconduct or ethical violations are fabrication and falsification of data. So fabrication is making up data. Falsification is manipulating data or omitting critical data. There's also plagiarism. And of course, I think you're all probably familiar with what plagiarism is, and I'm not going to go extensively into that. But I'm sure that your advisors can answer specific questions about that. Violation of ethical standards, so not following ethical practices for obtaining materials or for doing animal and human research. There's many of you are working on projects that are for companies, and you do not want to be spreading around the things, the ideas that you are having, so there would be ethical problem with violation of confidentiality agreements. And in general, in producing any sort of design or product, there's knowingly producing an unsafe product or being negligent in your design is, of course, another ethical violation. Murkier waters in terms of what is or is not ethical is unintentional publication of incorrect data. Again, if it's unintentional, it could be an honest mistake. General sloppiness is commonly put in that murkier water area sometimes, and suppression of negative results. So deliberately not publishing results that are adverse to your interests. Reasons why people commit scientific fraud. Most of these are pretty obvious. People like to get ahead. There's pressures within a company. There's pressures of cost, your company reputation, your job security. Within your class, there's pressures of your grade and succeeding in that, in your course. For scientists, there's their standing in the scientific community and that feeling that they need to publish. There's also sort of the egotistical reason sometimes where people just feel like they really know the right answer and are so convinced that it's right that they neglect to perform other experiments. So now I'm at the point where I'm going to talk about how to avoid misconduct. And actually, most forms of misconduct or ethical violations can really be easily avoided. In terms of plagiarism, cite your sources and follow common guidelines for not plagiarizing work. For animal and human subjects, follow your IACUC and IRB guidelines. Quickly report violations. If you're not familiar with what IACUC and IRB mean, then you should find out prior to doing any animal or human research. With respect to authorship, if you're publishing something or if you're writing a report, even make sure that all authors are included, that the report and such go out to all relevant parties that need to okay this communication. If you're publishing something, disclosing financial conflicts is also very important. Another thing to consider also is confidentiality, not doing unethical disclosures without the consent of the people who are your employers or your clients. And when designing a product, there's a whole list of things that you need to consider when constructing this product. And some of these are just a basic risk analysis. How risky is it going to be for people to use your product? Or even how risky is it going to be for people to make your product? What is the probability that someone is going to be injured when using your design or making your design? And you also have to consider that there's a different burden depending upon what kind of product you're making. An example that's given in some of the books is that even two products that are made of the same material but have different functions, there's a different responsibility associated with the two. So for instance, you have a knife and a paperclip. They're both made of the same metal, which maybe over time can harden and can break, causing an injury. Now, the company that makes the knife is actually expected to adhere to a much stricter standard of safety testing for that long-term, is it going to break while it's being used, than the company that makes the paperclip. So not all failures are the same. It really depends on how your product is used. You also should think about designing against foreseeable uses and foreseeable misuses. Of course, you cannot foresee every single misuse that a product may have. People do some pretty interesting things with products, but you should at least make an attempt to foresee how your product can be misused and how you can safeguard against that. Also, anticipating changes in your product over time. If it's a product that's going to be used for a lengthy period of time, you are expected to know sort of the failure, how your product may fail over time. And if you were working for a company, you could be liable for that product failing over time if it was something that could have been reasonably anticipated. In terms of how to avoid all of this misconduct and potential ethical violations, first, keep a good lab notebook. You all have design notebooks. Write in them. Write in them diligently every time you're doing something. That's a very good way to keep track of what you're doing. Another thing to consider is looking at codes of ethics. So if you are encountering any ethical problems or want to make sure that you're adhering to ethical standards, every engineering society has a code of ethics. BMES, so your biomedical engineers watching this probably, has its own code of ethics. National Society for Professional Engineers has a code of ethics. And these contain some really useful information that will help to guide you to make sure that you are behaving ethically and avoiding scientific misconduct. And lastly, I'm getting to this last because it's sort of a culmination of everything, but by far it is not the least important of what I've said, and that is that should you encounter an ethical problem, think of it like you approach your design problems. So in design, you have these multiple conflicting goals which should all be maximally satisfied. And that is exactly what an ethical problem is. Ethical problems are not necessarily these squishy things that don't have answers like you're used to in having engineering design. Engineering design, as you know, you're considering lots of different criteria, lots of different specifications, etc., and the same is true for your ethical problem. So if you start to approach your ethical problems like you approach your design, you'll find that you're able to understand the situations much better and come up with much better solutions for them. So just like you would never approach an engineering design problem without gathering lots of information, looking on the web for more information, talking to people, talking to experts in the field and your client and your advisor, etc. Similarly, you would never try to solve an ethical problem without trying to gather that same sort of information. So think about that when you do encounter something, and think about treating it like your design problem so that you can better work through it should something arise. And that's all I have to say today. Thank you for watching.